But now I will concentrate also more on these challenges, how biomass can be utilized. And first, we'll see a bit this global biomass potentials in forest and agriculture as a review that Erik Dahlqvist shown. And then we're going to go towards this project feedstock potentials, which were waste feedstocks, biodegradable waste fractions, like forest industry sludges and municipal based wastes. And then we'll see that how we would improve these biomass information that we have at the moment. So as we already heard, we have lots of biomass, and world's population is increasing dramatically, and it gives pressure to increase biomass use. And also we have this global warming effect, and now we have to somehow deal with these global threats, how to guarantee sustainable biomass flow as a food for these huge amounts of people in this world, and also as energy and chemicals for consumption. And as this project concentrated on biodegradable waste, I will talk about them, because non-food and waste biomass streams is seen as one of the solutions to these global threats. But still there is some challenges how to utilize these waste-based materials, and I'll talk about them as well. So there's a lots of biomass potential. Just want to remind you that global bioenergy potential is about 72 times the annual energy consumption in Finland. So it's a huge amount of potential that we have in biomass. But there will be there is some future scenarios about how and where biomass will grow in the future, and different future biomass potential scenarios, they predict that biomass energy potential will vary from 120 to about 200 exajoules per year by 2050, and will have a short review from different research papers that what's a global trend to this approach, because now it seems that Asia is the largest bioenergy user. It uses about three times more biomass that it can sustainably produce. This is a bit opposite than in Europe, where we will have about 4 exajoules per year of sustainable biomass, forest biomass potential, where our current use is about less than current sustainable potential. And in case of forest biomass in Europe, the forecast is that we will have more forest biomass, but still the global trend would be that forest biomass potential would go down from 42 exajoules to 30 exajoules per year by 2050. This is a VTT scenario prediction, and probably it is because there is need to occupy agricultural land due to cost of decreasing forest land. And in globally, this would mean that these scenarios, they predict that agro-based biomass potential would be doubled by 2050 up to about 104 exajoules per year. And especially in Europe, there's seen a huge need to increase agricultural biomass potential. And in EU, we have, of course, these 2020 targets that are forcing towards this huge increase in biomass use, which is quite nice in our opinion. But what were the interesting feedstock materials in this project, where we have these five target regions? In Notsavo, in Kuopio, forest industry sludge, for example, and in Lithuania and in Estonia, we had agricultural feedstock were tested in dry digestion system. There were manures and agricultural waste materials, like algae, also in Lithuania. And very interesting scenario in Vestmanland province, there was a dry digestion system for municipal solid residual waste. And in Poland, potato waste was also tested. And these main waste fractions are shown here that represent about the materials that were tested in this project, which are industrial effluent sludges. In total, in European Union, the potential for this industrial sludge is about 10 million tons per year. And for example, in Savonsellu, in pulp and paper board factory, there was sludge production about 20,000 tons per year. And it would be quite nicely, for example, for a biorefinery. But still, there is smaller waste fractions, sludges and liquid wastes from wastewater treatment plants all around from Europe. And also we would have interesting potentials from animal and vegetable wastes. In totally in Europe, around 100 million tons. And as you can see, the largest potentials in these project target regions, they are in Germany and Poland, but in this case, Germany partners are here acting as experts for the project. But because of we have so many interesting waste materials, actually the question is that how to start to utilize these waste-based materials. Because these waste materials, they have different properties that affect on their utilization. Their properties can vary quite a lot, even in single waste origin. For example, like total solid concentration in wastewater treatment plant, in the end of it can vary quite a lot. For example, from 1 to 6% dry matter for a mixed sludge in the end of the process. And then we have lots of regulations that have effect on this waste utilization. We must have certain heavy metal limits for materials that can be used as fertilizer. And it was very nice to hear this presentation from Professor Lin about how to remove these heavy metals, because they are really important, and in system analysis approach they are also considered. And then we must be sure that these residuals from the biological processes, they are safe for the environment and for people. And we have also these greenhouse gas reduction demands, 60% after 2018 for biofuel production systems, as well as not only these nasty regulations, but then we have finance policy subsidies that we should consider in economical calculations. And because we have so many regulations, we should start to think about how to model these different scenarios. And because we had very nice workshop in Estonia, I decided to take example from there, that how, for example, household biowaste could be utilized in Estonia, and what kind of potentials we could have available, and how much of that potential we actually could use. In case of, we have 39 kilotons per year of household biowaste in Estonia, we could utilize about 19 kilotons per year of it when we consider that operational income is positive over the whole production chain, from transportation to the delivery of heat and electricity. As well as, we have to also think about regional impacts. In this case, there was modeled these waste collection areas where inside the system is still economically reasonable. And not only these waste amounts, we have to care about how much greenhouse gas emissions we could save, and report them as done in this project, and also labor demands for these kind of systems. And I'm not go into very detailed level to this table, but actually the message is that we need to somehow model these different scenarios, how to start to utilize waste-based materials, because there's lots of regulations included to this utilization. And that's why we are actually involved in a Biomass Atlas Finland project, which aims to increase the knowledge about these biomass potentials and how they could be utilized. And this is actually now picture about a web application that was developed in Remove project before Abor project. And now the case is in Finland that we are aiming to develop a national scale application about how to map these different biomasses and how to consider these sustainability things, how much actually we could utilize. But this this project, hopefully it will be accepted, because now we are preparing it, and there's lots of Finnish research organizations involved also this project, and Finnish Agri-Food Research Center is leading this project, and we are there as giving modeling tools for this larger platform. So what's conclusions of this presentation is that there is happening land use change globally, and we need to somehow model those effects, as well as there is global threats like global warming, and we need to test these scenarios in many aspects, and for that we need to also improve the quality of data, because at the moment globally it's not in my opinion in very good level, and we need to bring the information for decision makers that we could make better decisions how to utilize biomass. And so far this INSPIRE directive is been very good for these purposes, and I want to very much thank those people that are worked with this directive, because it has given very good boost for this development to make this information available for many people that make decisions. So thank you very much, and I give this stage to next questions, and thank you.